So we have been developing a one-step ahead predictor for our max model. And in my last class, I showed you one way of developing this predictor. Okay? We distinguish between prediction of y and y measured. You should clearly understand the difference. Prediction of y based on the past information is different from y measured. Y measured actually is the value of measured variable collected from data acquisition system. Prediction is an estimate. There might be different ways of predicting, so there's no unique prediction. But the measurement is, once it is obtained, it is unique. It is not, or it is in some sense invariant. You cannot change the measurement. Okay. So I showed you one possible way of doing predictions. The idea was to bring everything that is y and u into my prediction equation. This is an alternate way of doing predictions. We'll just go over it once more. So now other way is to use predicted residuals. We use predicted y, we can use predicted residuals and then do predictions. Okay? So here to begin with, I am showing you two predictions. Suppose I have this, I have constructed estimate y hat k minus 1 given k minus 2. This is prediction of y at instant k minus 1 using information up to k minus 2. Okay? So same thing is here. This is prediction of y at instant k minus 2 using information up to k minus 3. Let's go back to our equation. We were looking at second order Arma model. Second order Arma model we had rearranged like this. Y hat k given k minus 1 was weighted sum of past measurements, past inputs, manipulated inputs or known inputs to the system. And now I am retaining these past two errors. Now just notice here, earlier I had this term Ek. Ek is the white noise which we have hypothesized drives the model. Okay. I do not have measurement of Ek. I'm going to use an estimate of this error, this estimate of the error between y measured and y predicted. This difference I'm going to use as an impostor, okay, somebody who imitates the true innovations, so-called true innovations, or so-called true error. So I'm constructing an estimate of E. The estimate of E is constructed using difference between y measured and y predicted at each instant, and that is used in my model. Okay. So now I want to start doing predictions. Okay, I can make a simplifying assumption that in the beginning of modeling exercise, at time equal to 0, the two errors are equal to 0. Expected value of E0, E1 and E2 is equal to 0. This is a simplifying assumption. This is a simplifying assumption. I want to do predictions using y, u and error. Okay, if I have first three errors, then subsequent errors can be generated using this equation. I only have problem when I start doing using this equation from time 0 to time capital N. Okay, my only problem is first three instances. If I somehow have some guess for these first three instances, so I'm going to make an assumption. Well, our error E is a zero mean signal. Best estimate for this signal is 0. Okay, so it's justified to use 0, 0, 0 in the beginning. So now what I'm going to do is, given this model parameter, now in optimization, what do? You guess unknown parameters. Okay. Then using the guessed values, you construct the prediction errors, and then we minimize some of the square of prediction errors. That is the idea. So first three prediction errors, we are arbitrarily choosing them equal to 0. Okay, first three only. After that, see what happens. If you make that simplifying assumption, what happens is that if I make this assumption, then what is Y3? See, Y2 is the measurement at instant 2, Y1 is the measurement at instant 1. They are available, U1, U0 are available, and E2, E1, we have assumed them to be 0. That is our simplifying assumption. Okay, so I get Y hat 3 given 2. With this, I can estimate E3. Okay, I can estimate E3. Then, you know, I go to Y4. Y4 needs E3 and E2. E2 we have assumed to be 0. Okay, E3 got calculated here. Okay, and then I get estimate for E4. Is everyone with me on this? Just check what I am doing. Okay. Once you give me a guess for parameters A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, C2, and then make this simplifying assumption of E0 equal to 0, E1 equal to 0, E2 equal to 0. Then, if you have large data set, these first three elements being assumed to be 0 doesn't make a difference. Okay. Typically, we will have large data set, and this doesn't really cause much problem. Particularly if you make an assumption that the disturbance model, unknown disturbance model, is stable and inversely stable, this is perfectly valid assumption, making 3 to be equal to 0. So that's not going to cause a problem in the identification. Well, I can just go on doing this now. See, once I have E4 and E5, I can go on using them recursively in my prediction. This is just writing a for loop. When I am writing a program, I am just writing a for loop going from time 3 to time n. I just go on doing this calculation. For every guess of parameters, I can estimate this. Okay. So what is done in the optimization? In optimization, you give a guess. Okay. You give a guess for A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, C2. For every guess, we have knowledge of y and u, we construct these predictions, then we estimate E3, E4, E5 up to En. Okay, this just goes on, and then we minimize some of the square of errors with respect to these parameters. Okay, the theta here is nothing but this parameter set A1, A2, B1, B2, B. And what does parameter optimization algorithm do? It will estimate the objective function based on the gradient of the objective function. It will give you, or some method, gradient or Hessian of the objective function. It will construct a new guess, and you keep iteratively trying different values of the algorithm of the parameters till you reach some local optimum, minimum. Okay, some optimization, some minimization criteria satisfied. So that is this problem has to be solved iteratively. Okay, as you can see, for some simple systems, I showed you a demonstration of MATLAB toolbox last time. This can be done very, very quickly. You know, it takes probably a few seconds now doing these kind of calculations, optimization calculations. So this is a constrained optimization problem. So epsilon is actually computed using this particular equation. Of course, you don't have to use a constrained equation here. You can eliminate and use simple unconstrained methods, unless you want to constrain this A1, A2, B1, B2, and so on. But that's a little advanced thing, whether to constrain them or not to constrain them. Ideally, we should constrain them because we want the noise model to be stable and inversely stable. But if you try to pose a constraint problem, there are some difficulties. And there have been methods of handling them that is kind of part of current research, not really. So it's very important to give good initial guess. It's an optimization problem. It's very, very important to design inputs correctly. It's very, very important to choose structure correctly, all kinds of things. So let me just summarize the prediction error method. Okay, let's go back and see what we have done. we have give for every guess of parameter that are to be estimated, we actually compute this y hat k and error, okay, and then we minimize some of the square of errors with respect to these parameters to be estimated. That is the, what if there is a time delay or dead time in this system, that is typically estimated a priori based on some other method, and that is just used while constructing the model. Time delay estimation using this becomes difficult because time delay is an integer variable. You know, you have a time delay of 3 samples or 4 samples, and if you notice here, these are all continuous values. A1, A2, B1, B2, C1, C2 can take continuous values. They can be real numbers. So we don't really get into solving a integer, mixed integer, nonlinear programming problem. That becomes a little difficult. Okay, so let me summarize this. So I have this data. I have done some experiments, and I have collected this data for some capital N. Capital N should be typically large. How large? You as practicing engineer, knowing about the plant, knowing about the domain dynamics of the system, you have to decide. Okay, you can probably come up with some help from statistics and linear algebra, but then it's a joint call. It is not completely automated. Your expertise as a domain expert is very, very important here. Then we choose some model structure. How do you parameterize G? How do you parameterize H? Whether you choose ARMA model, AR model, ARX model, all that is up to you. You have to again come up with what is feasible, what is data length, very, very complex issues, though it looks very simple here. Then I do this optimal predictor. I just showed you how to construct optimal predictor for some simple cases. Now the nice thing about this optimal predictor is that it right hand side only involves known signals U and Y. Okay, it doesn't involve unknown signal E, innovations. Innovations are actually constructed. E is a signal which is actually a fabricated signal. Okay, and you can see that that signal is nothing but here Y minus Y hat. So we expect this to be a white noise, a zero mean white noise signal. Typically zero mean Gaussian white noise signal, each one of them a stationary process, white noise stationary process with. And when do we stop? How do you know whether the model identified is good or bad? This epsilon sequence which you get after estimation of the model, okay, should be a white noise, very, very critical. Okay, and then you minimize, typically you minimize some of the square of errors. Somebody might ask me, why sum of the square, why not sum of absolute errors, why not infinite norm, minimize maximum error, maximum of the absolute error, minimize maximum of the absolute error. You can do that perfectly fine. Okay, why we use two norm is because two norm is associated with lot of rich properties. But first of all, those of you who have done this numerical methods course, two norm comes with it's on a Hilbert space, right? So you have inner product, you have a lot of rich theory associated with two norm, and you can interpret it through projections. Then in this case you can use something called Parseval's theorem and then transform or do analysis using frequency domain. There are a lot of things which come with two norm. It is very, very helpful to do analysis. It becomes difficult to do analysis with one norm or infinite norm. So if I use sum of absolute errors, it is perfectly fine, but analysis becomes difficult. Okay, analysis is very easy, particularly with two norm. That's why least square estimation is so popular. Estimating covariance of parameter estimates, estimating some theoretical properties. I'm just going to hint at those properties right now. I don't have time to get into derivations or talk about it fully, because in this course, modeling is one aspect. We have to proceed and go to control. and said estimation. So with this lecture and the next lecture, I'm going to wind up the control relevant modeling. I'm going to go over some things very quickly, okay, which will probably cause some discomfort because there'll be some complex expressions here. But right now, idea is to sensitize you that there are many more complex issues here. Okay, I probably would need entire 40 lectures to really go into depth of these things. We many times run this course, system identification and state estimation separately. This year it is not running, but if it runs next year, maybe you can think of crediting or auditing that course. So that will give you a much broader perspective of what is happening. Okay, so let's go back to our two tank data that we have. Okay, if I actually do this parameter estimation using MATLAB toolbox, this is the model that I get. And of course, as I told you, the model consists of these ABC polynomials, and it also consists of the statistical properties of noise E, which have been estimated from data. So the model has two components: deterministic component, which is coming by B and A, stochastic component, which is coming through C and A, okay, together with noise properties. Okay, we actually wanted EK to be zero mean. It is almost zero mean. It is not equal to zero mean. It is almost zero mean, and estimate of the variance. How is this estimate of the variance obtained? Using the sum of the square of errors divided by 1 upon n. That will give you estimate. Actually, I have given this formula. So this objective function itself divided by 1 by n will give you estimate of the variance. Okay. So that is after you have optimized for this particular optimum values, estimate of lambda square is variance of E, is given here. Okay. MATLAB toolbox will give you this information. You should know how to use it. That is very, very important. Okay. So, or even Scilab, if you are using Scilab toolbox, or there are many statistical open source software. I'm sure they, some of them have this time series modeling. So they will give you all this information. You should know what is meaning of all this. Okay, so second order Ar-max model is pretty good. I had shown you these results earlier. The innovations are almost a white noise. Innovations and inputs are almost uncorrelated. So it's a good model. We have extracted, or we have separated deterministic component and stochastic component. Okay, we have model for unknown disturbances. We have model for known component. We can go ahead and use this for design of controllers. Sir, yeah. We have to go back and say that whether my model order is correct. Should I go back and change from second order to third order? Both will change. If you want to change only deterministic order, not change the noise model order, then you should not use Ar-max. You should use Box Jenkins. Structure should be different. See, we have this different structures. The trouble with Ar-max model, well, why I have introduced Ar-max model, it's simple to teach and understand the concept. But the trouble with Ar-max model that it has common denominator polynomial for noise and for deterministic, which sometimes is not a great idea. What you are saying is correct. This having same A and for noise and this thing, it will have poles for deterministic and stochastic component clubbed together. You may have some difficulties because of that. If you want to separate them, you can separately parameterize. So this can be third order, this can be first order, you know, you can do that. Okay, only the algebra becomes a little more complex. Okay. Everything is same. You do H inverse G in plus 1 minus H inverse Y. Everything is same. Nothing changes. Okay. So the prediction error method can very much be used. Not an issue. Okay. And you can separately parameterize the noise model. In fact, a better idea is to separately parameterize the noise model. Okay, so Ar-max model, of course, you can always convert this model into this model. Suppose I do cross multiplication and have a common denominator. Okay, I can have a common denominator which is aq minus 1 into dq minus 1. Do you see that? See, this is, you can do polynomial algebra just like fraction algebra, no? You can just multiply. So I can define a model where this will be D into B divided by AD plus C into A divided by AD. That converts it into this form. Okay. By the way, please understand that these are just representative forms. When I am writing this and this here, that doesn't mean that this B is equal to this B. It is not that. These are just representations. These are representations. Okay. So when I am writing ARX model, RMAX model, I still keep using A, B. You know, actually for a same system, RMAX model probably should be A tilde, and you know, BJ should be A cap or some other notation, because they are different. They will not be identical. But it's, you know, that will make the notation so complex that so these are just representations, okay. And you can see here, you can convert this form into this form and so on, okay. A better understanding of this will come, of course, we are solving those problems, and we'll have those, we'll have two more, one or two more sessions for before the mid-sem for problem solving. But the real understanding of this will come when you start doing a project. I've been waiting for finishing this component. So post mid-sem we'll start a project. So what we have done is we have collected five different systems, and we are going to give group projects. Okay. So you simulate the system, you actually introduce noise, you get data, then you put it into ident, get different models, then you know you will get a feel of these numbers. Because all these statistical things, if you do using hand, using some three or four values, doesn't make sense. You should do it in MATLAB, and we'll have some sessions where you start doing these projects. So there are two or three models from chemical engineering, then two models from chemical engineering, two reactor models, two models from bio domain, which I think anyone can understand. There's some model for monitoring insulin, monitoring blood glucose concentration using insulin infusion. Some three equation model, simple model, very, very simple model. So those models will cut across any branch. System is known to you, human body, and then you know you are very, very close to you. So and you can appreciate what happens if glucose goes high and glucose goes low. You don't need any special engineering domain knowledge for appreciating. What it will also tell you is that these methods that we are talking about modeling and control, they just cut across, I mean, the boundaries of disciplines, that it is belongs to this or that, doesn't make sense. They are modeling tools that can be used for any system. Okay. Okay. So let's go to this model. I showed you various ways of assessing the model quality. Okay. What we do is we compare model predictions. See, you take data, you divide it into two parts. One part is for model identification, other part is for model validation. A model identified using part A of the data should be able to predict part B data. Because, see, this data has been used, I'll show you that particular thing. This data has been used, one part of the data has been used for, is it here? I'm going to show you this case study. So this is what is done. You conduct an experiment, you take this part of the data for model identification, and then this part of the data you call for model validation. If I identify a model using this part of the data, it should predict this data. Then only your model is good. How do you know? See, when you are minimizing the sum of the square of errors on this, the identification, you know, will show you perfect results. It should predict an unknown situation. Then the model is good, okay. Maybe I'll present, I'll rearrange, do some. I'll I'll present this case study first before I move to some of the issues that I want to talk about. Yeah. Oh, no, no, actually, there's nothing like that. You can have both of them same. You conduct two different experiments with the similar characteristics, and then you can use one experiment set for model identification, the other experiment set for.
Because we use too much of data for estimate to be biased. We use less percentage of data, the estimate doesn't come good. So, usually, there is.
There's nothing like that. You use. Say basically, if I conduct an experiment for 5 hours, well, I have taken larger data set for model identification, because to keep the parameter estimation, variance of parameter estimates low, I need n to be large. Okay, that's why if you conduct only one experiment, then you tend to take larger data for identification, smaller data for. If you conduct multiple experiments, if you are trying to do that, then not an issue. You can have two different experiments conducted, one dedicated only for model identification, the next one for model validation. Absolutely fine. Not an issue. So before I move to some of the issues in identification, let me present a case study. Okay, there are a lot of okay, let me present selectively some two slides before I move on. And then we'll move on to case study, then we'll come back to the issues. So, what are the steps in model? One of the most important thing is model structure selection. You have to a priori, first of all, know what is available in your basket, what are the different model structures available to you. I have talked about a limited set, linear difference equations, okay, linear stochastic difference equations. They are stochastic difference equations, mind you, because they are being driven by known inputs as well as innovation, white noise, okay, zero mean white noise signal. So it's a set which is linear stochastic difference equations, what we are using. Again, within that, you know, you have ARX, RMAX, ARMA, OE, all kinds of things, and you have to make a judgment what you want. Maybe in some situations you are not bothered about disturbance modeling, you just want a deterministic component correctly. You should go for output error model structure. Okay, but as theory shows that even to get good estimate of deterministic component, you may have to model the noise. Okay, so that part is, I am not going to cover that aspect so much deep, I'll just show pointers. As I said, if I have to give justice to all those things, probably I need to spend entire semester, which I don't want to do. So model structure selection is very, very important. It's even important before you start, experiments, because if you are going to do ARX models, okay, or finite impulse response models, the number of coefficients is going to be large. You better conduct experiments for a longer time. So all these decisions are correlated, they are not independent. You have to understand this. And you have to understand this particularly with the backdrop that now all these modeling tools are available to you at a fingertip. Okay. So when I was a graduate student, 20 years back, we had to write our own program to make this, and writing a program for this itself would be some MTech project to write a PEM method. Now it's not even a course tutorial, so it's reduced to that. So, but you should know what you are using. You have hammers, but you should know what you are doing. I just talked about linear difference models. There is a whole lot of things called nonlinear ARX models, NARMAX models, nonlinear, you have all those neural nets and wave nets, and then there are so many other options by which you can construct nonlinear difference equation models. We have just talked about one simplest set. Why linear difference equation models? because linear difference equations are mathematically treatable very, very, very easily. You can treat linear difference equations. You can do design of controllers and all that very easily. That's why we, but in some cases, in some situations, linear difference equation models will not be useful. And in those cases, you have to take a call what model you want to use, linear or nonlinear. And then once you go for a nonlinear model, you have to, of course, use nonlinear controller design methods and so on. But my prescription would be simple things first. First, try linear difference equation models. If they don't seem to work, or if you know from physics that linearity is not going to work in this particular situation, then only you should go for a more complex structure. Next thing is that you have to plan suitable set of experiments. You have to design input perturbation sequence. Okay. You have to worry about whether to do the experiment in open loop or closed loop. Now I'll tell you why. You are using linear models. Okay. Now linear model is not valid if you develop a linear model for a plant which is operating at one operating conditions. If the operating conditions change tomorrow, okay, which can very well happen in a chemical plant. Let's say you have a refinery which is working using Gulf crude and you decide to shift to Bombay High crude. Okay, the characteristics of Bombay High crude are different. Operating conditions change completely. The linear model which is valid for Gulf crude will not be valid for Bombay High crude. Okay, so these are ultimately perturbation models. Okay, or when we go to that diabetes model. Okay, the model, if the model is nonlinear, if you linearize it at one operating point, the predictions will not match the behavior at some other operating point. So if the operating condition changes, if the glucose level changes from say 100 to 30, the predictions at 30 will be different. You cannot use the same linear model. So you may have to inject the perturbations at 30. And now the question is that when you are doing this, injecting the perturbation, should it be in open loop or should it be in closed loop? Open loop is that no insulin is given. Okay, maybe dangerous if the glucose levels are too low and no insulin is given, no control is there. Okay, and you are perturbing the plant, you are on a dangerous territory. Okay, you better control the system and inject the perturbations. Okay, so in a reactor, you may be in a region where it is very high pressure and temperature. It is dangerous to operate. If you inject perturbation without the controller being present, so there is some controller designed earlier. It is already active. We found that the controller is not performing well. We want to change the model, retune the controller. This is the scenario I am talking about. Okay. Now in such a situation, should I take the controller off or should the controller be on? Operator is more comfortable if controller is on. Okay. He doesn't want to take off the controller. And as a modeler, you will say no, open loop is better. But open loop is not practical sometimes. Now, if you decide to do perturbations in closed loop, there is huge mathematical implications. The noise in the measurement becomes correlated with the inputs U, and then entire things becomes messy. Maths becomes very, very messy. You cannot use the methods which I described in a straightforward manner. You have to do lot of maths to clean the data of the noise. So the input and output in some sense become correlated. That causes problems in estimation. I have hinted at this in my tutorial. If you saw the tutorial, I have given one small problem with proportional feedback and showed that some matrices, this omega matrix will become rank deficient and so on. Okay, when we do that exercise, we'll realize. So identification, whether to do it in closed loop or open loop, is a tricky question. And when you are actually re-identifying a plant while the plant is running, an operator would prefer that you do it in closed loop. But closed loop identification is a tricky business. There are very few commercial products right now. People are working on actually developing products which can do model identification online while the controller is on. Okay, it's a hot research topic and very much valued by industry. Yeah, there are so many issues, yes. that is also one of the argument which is advanced, that you know it might drift somewhere. The other argument which is advanced is, you know, you might, when the controller is on, you actually excite the plant in the frequency range which is relevant to the closed loop, which is not possible when it is an open loop, and so many other issues. So there are people who are for it and for against it. So it's a debate which is still an inconclusive debate. You have to take a call on depending upon the particular situation. You cannot, there are no global answers to this, what should be done. Yes, in some sense, yes. What you are saying is yes. So how do you know a priori if the plant is not running? So there are chicken and egg problems, you know, what comes first? And so how do you design an input itself becomes a very critical thing. So typically you use optimization techniques, and model validation you have to perform by multiple ways. You have to see whether the steady state properties of the model are good or not, the gain is correct or not. You know, you expect the gain to be positive and it turns out to be negative from estimation. Something wrong with your model. So all kinds of things which you have to so there are multiple things, you know, I don't know whether many of you know what I am saying here, because for chemical chemical engineering students, batch and continuous is not difficult to understand. A chemical plant has, you know, the crude oil coming continuously from some source, some oil well, let's say, or some sump. It is continuously being processed, and the products are continuously being pumped to different destinations. So let's say you have a crude oil, then you separate it into aviation turbo fuel and diesel and gasoline, and this process is happening continuously. All the time the feed keeps coming and it gets separated and sent. These are called continuous processes. The other kind of processes are batch processes, where there is something starts, then there is some operation and then it stops. Best example in our home for a batch process is cooking. Okay, so you take rice in the cooker, then you raise the temperature to a certain point, then you operate it for, look at it from a control viewpoint, you operate it at a constant temperature for some, you know, 9 minutes or 11 minutes or whatever, you wait for some whistles, and then you switch off, then the temperature should come down, right, before you can open it. So it's a control problem, which we do it by hand. A real life situation in chemical engineering is specialty chemicals, pharmaceuticals. You produce, you know, some specialty chemicals or drugs in a, not a cooker, but a reactor, which is called as a batch reactor or a semi-batch reactor, in which you put things, okay, and let them cook, let them react. So you have some recipe, there is a batch recipe, you heat it up to a certain point, then the reaction starts, then the reaction might be exothermic, so you may have to cool it. And so there are all kinds of, the other batch process is aircraft flight. You take it off to a certain level, cruise it, and then it stops, right? You come down on the analog, continuous time analog for this kind of a system would be, of chemical engineering, would be a satellite. A satellite never, once it takes off, it is there. I mean, if you take it, that it never stops, it's a continuous time system, which is, once it is there, it is there, you know, in the orbit. And so it also depends upon what kind of application you have in mind. I'll be talking about this prediction. So what kind of model you want to develop depends upon what is the availability of data, you know, how much time you have at your disposal. So there are, I mean, modeling, if you ask me, in a control project, what is most important part is modeling and not the control. Once you have a good model, you know, doing control is relatively much easier, because, you know, once you put the system behavior into nice differential equations, we know how to go about, you know, we are master at working in this ideal world of equations. But translating the reality into something that is, those are equations which mimic the plant or the system reasonably well, whether it is mechanistic model, whether it is gray box model, whether it is black box model, whatever it is. Doing that is the most tricky part. And in complex control schemes where people implement them, the people who can do modeling are paid much higher probably than those who can operate. Because if you know how to model, you know, you have done 70% of the work in a control project. Yeah, you had some question. Distillation can be done in both batch or continuous. So the crude oil distillation which I was talking to you is like a continuous process. It probably this they do, I mean, if you take a very large viewpoint of 100 years, it's a batch process. But we call it continuous because once you start, you will not stop it for 1 year or so. Once you start this process, for 1 year, okay, at a larger time scale, everything is a batch process. Okay, but because sometime you have to do a startup and sometime you have to do a shutdown. We call it continuous because once I start it, for 1 year it's going to run. Okay, but the other batches which I am talking about, see, let's say I am preparing some specialty drug. Okay, so once I react it for some one day, let's say it takes to react and get mixture where you get the formulation. Then you get a mixture which has product and reactants both together. Now you need to separate the products. Okay. Now that has to be done in the distillation, but that is called batch distillation because you are going to only process, you know, some 100 kg of material. It will take some 4 days, not 4 days, it may take some 4 hours or 5 hours. Okay. So that is called a batch process. Okay. So this batch and continuous is relative. That's true. So if the crude oil supply dries up, well, your plant is shut, it is not. So when you say continuous, it is pseudo-continuous. Okay. So what I would say is that the model granularity, what kind of model you want to develop? First principle model, linear model, black box model, gray box model, you know, non-linear gray box model, whatever. It all depends upon what is the application. What is the system? What is the data available? You know, you have to take a call. So please remember, even though we are doing with data-driven modeling, your role as an engineer who knows physics is not less important. It is equally important. You cannot develop good models unless you know physics of the system well. Okay? So this is a tool which has to be used in conjunction with your knowledge of physics. It cannot be. So that's why as a control engineer, I am better suited to develop models in chemical industry because my background is in chemical engineering. And a mechanical engineer is better suited to develop models for a robotic problem because he knows those issues, or for a car, or, you know. So those things are important. Statistics part, anyone can pick up. The domain knowledge, you know, is important. How do you solve this problem? Typically, there are two methods. One is nonlinear optimization. There is also this method called Gauss-Newton method, which is also quite popular, which is used. And those of you who have not done this should probably look at what is Gauss-Newton method. There are a number of issues, you know. Do you want to emphasize certain frequency content in your model? Okay. I know that the model, the plant actually operates in this frequency range. This knowledge is known to you from your physics, from your understanding of the system. And you can use it to shape up the objective function. So instead of minimizing the sum of the square of errors, okay, I can choose to minimize a filtered version of this. I can construct this epsilon, pass it through a shaping filter, okay, and then it's a bandpass filter. And that bandpass filter will allow you to cut off some high frequencies from this and focus on low frequencies. How to choose this filter is a.
Can we never get a white noise?
Which one?
Ultimately, we try to.
No. We want a white noise, but we are minimizing. We are minimizing the filtered value of it. Objective function is different. Okay, we still want epsilon to be white noise. Okay. But what is being minimized is, yeah, whether you will always get a white noise or not is a good question. I too have to If you do this, are you guaranteed to get a white noise? Is a question that is quite critical.
Yes.
I too have to go back and check whether you are guaranteed to get white noise. Then there are issues like model order selection. Okay. See, one thing which you will find when you are doing any data fitting. Okay. If you have a model with 4 parameters, okay, and if you have a model with 10 parameters, 10 parameter model will always seem to fit better. Okay, as compared to 4 parameter model. Now, which one I should use? Visually, it looks like, you know, 10 parameter model is better. So, like sometimes they say in parameter estimation, you know, if you give me 10 parameters, I can fit an elephant into data, and if you give me 12, I can make the elephant walk. So you can, you know, make seemingly better and better model if you have more parameters. But then there are so many issues. More parameters means larger data length, means longer experiment time, means loss of production. And so what is done is that when you are comparing different, see, actually when you are identifying a model for a system for which you are guessing the order, okay, you do not know. When you are given some data in this simple system of 2 tanks, you can say, okay, it is second order or third order. You go to a real plant where you have power plant. No, you have some complex boiler system. What is the order? Very difficult decision to make. So you start trying different orders. Second order, third order, fourth order. Smaller the better. Okay. And but you have to take a call. What order model I should fit? So we actually use this criteria called archaic information criteria. Okay. To decide which model is good. So it uses 2 things. If you see here, it uses sum of the square of errors. See, just because you have a small sum of the square of errors doesn't mean the model is better. Okay. We use 2 things. One is this information criteria weighs sum of the square of errors. It also weighs the number of model parameters. Okay. So we compare a model with 5 parameters and with 10 parameters using this criteria. If you see here, a 10 parameter model will have this component more. It may have this component less, but this component more. Okay. So this criteria tries to balance between number of model parameters and some of the square of errors which reduce because of number of model parameters. Okay. So you compare different models using so prediction. So there is one term which is prediction term, which is this term. This tells you how well the model fits the data, and the model n is some sense, you know, measure of a complexity of your model. You know, more the parameters, more complex model you have. So model order selection, you have to gain experience in doing this. I mean, no book will ever tell you how to choose the model order. You have to see a lot of data, you have to fit in data, use that model, those models, and then you will get so you penalize in this archaic information criteria, you penalize the model complexity by adding including this term or some penalty on n number of model parameters. And then, you know, this is not the only thing that you have to bother about. You have to bother about variance errors, you have to bother about something called bias errors. I'm coming to that. So typically you use archaic information criteria. I have given you here one information criteria. There are more information criteria in the literature. The Bayesian information criteria, and there are some other methods of comparing models. But this is a crucial question. If you have data, if you are developing models of different order, how do you compare them? Okay, you might be developing simple correlation, you know, simple correlation model. Whether to use a first order polynomial, second order polynomial, third order polynomial, okay, which is better? So you can use this archaic information criteria, not just for time series modeling. You can use it anywhere, archaic information criteria. Okay. So that is how you can use to compare models. Well, real systems are multiple input, multiple output. No real system is, truly single input, single output. Single input, single output, we study in the first course because everything is easy to understand the concepts. You know, digest the concept is easy, and in many cases, you know, some simple systems approximating a CISO system works. Okay, so not every time you require very complex things, but real complex systems in today's world, they are tightly integrated and they are difficult to use single loop controllers. You have to use multivariable controllers. Okay, this is more and more so because of tight energy integration, mass integration, and all kinds of complex designs that are coming up. You no longer have systems which are, you know, can be done with. So you have to use multivariable. You have to develop multivariable models. Multiple inputs affect multiple outputs simultaneously, and you have to model in a power plant or in a boiler. You can appreciate if I change the fuel flow, it's going to change variety of things, not just, you know, one parameter. Okay, it's going to change pressure, it's going to change the level inside the boiler, it's going to change the oxygen content in the, you know, flue gas. It's multiple things what happens. And this is for everything. You change one thing, it has effect on multiple outputs. So in reality, we have to develop MIMO models, multiple input, multiple output models. Problem is much more complex. Now, there are issues. When I have multiple inputs, do I perturb them simultaneously? Or do I perturb them one at a time? Okay, one at a time looks nice. You know, you can segregate effect of one input, but not practical. Because if you have a boiler which has 5 inputs, okay, you perturb for one input for one day and 5 experiments for 5 days, you are wasting, you know, the steam for 5 days, not affordable. You better perturb all 5 simultaneously, do experiment for 1 day. Okay, collect your data and do modeling. Nobody is going to allow you to do experiments for 5 days. So these are the issues in real life that you have to worry about. ARX model can be very easily converted into MIMO model, multiple input, multiple output model, not an issue. Okay. The trouble is the number of parameters to be estimated just blows up. Okay, so some industrial data I was trying to use ARX models. You know, we had 5 outputs, 7 inputs. With respect to each input output pair, I required 40 parameters to get. So huge number of parameters. Of course, the data was there for 23 days. So I could do a lot of, I had huge data. So I could use a model which has large number of parameters, but you need large number of parameters if you have ARX model. You can do simultaneous modeling of multiple input, multiple output, but and you can get solutions very easily. That least square estimation just scales up. Doesn't matter whether you are working with scalars or vectors. It just works very well. But there are issues in terms of number of data points. These models, output error model, Ermac's model, Boggs-Jenkins models. What you do is you develop what are called as MISO models, multiple input, single output models, and then you fuse them to create a MIMO model. That is typically what is done. Okay, so this MISO modeling is done. How do you excite the input? Well, it's a tricky business, as I said. Whether you do it sequentially and simultaneously, and you will still find people writing papers. What is the best way of doing it and not a sorted issue. What should be my, there are so many issues. When you design an input signal, what should be my choice of input signal? Should I use this signal or this signal? Both are pseudo-random binary signals, but they have different frequency content. You can see that this has very low frequency content, this has very high frequency content. How do I know this? I look at the power spectrum, okay? I look at the power spectrum. This signal here has this power spectrum. It has a lot of frequency content, a lot of power at low frequencies, but it has almost no power at high frequencies. Okay. Whereas this signal has almost no power at low frequencies, but significant power at middle frequencies. Okay. Which excitation I should introduce? Golden question. Okay, you should know the system. You should know the system. What at what time scale or at what frequency scale the system operates. Unless you know that, you cannot make this call. And this is very, very, very crucial call. If you do not introduce the right frequency perturbations, your data will not be useful for modeling, because it will give you a model in the wrong frequency region. Why will it give you a model in the wrong frequency region? Well, I will talk about that a little later. One issue that is very, very important is what is called as persistency of excitation. I have tried to teach this concept through an exercise problem of talking about estimating parameters of a two-parameter model in which step input is given. And I have tried to show that step input will not be useful. Step input will give you, you know, this matrix to be rank deficient, and then you will have trouble estimating model parameters if you have. So how do you put up the plant is actually a becomes an art, and guided by maths and the physics both. You know, so this persistency of excitation is actually technically defined as rank of this matrix, correlation matrix of inputs. If you want to identify a model with n parameters with reference to the input, this rank should be equal to n. That is critical. If it is not, your model will be, you know, the results that you get from your identification exercise, even if you use the best package, the results that you get is a garbage. That you have to understand. See, now you have good, powerful packages. When you are giving data and you are not making any mistake on numerical side, okay? If you are getting a wrong model, if you are getting a, and even a good package there can give you garbage because you have fed in garbage. That you have to understand. If you do not excite the plant properly, if you do not make sure that this matrix rank is, you know, consistent with the choice of model order, okay? See, if I want to identify a model of third order, then this matrix should have at least rank 3. If I want to identify a model of fifth order, this matrix should have at least rank 5, and so on. Okay, so it is not that given a data, I can develop a model of any order. Okay, if your input is not, you know, persistently exciting of order 10, you cannot develop an order 10 model. Very, very important. Where do these parameters, where do these things appear in the equation? See here, this RU, R1, R0, these are appearing here. Okay, this submatrix here, rank of this submatrix actually is very, very critical. Rank of this submatrix. It should be 2. If it is not 2, you have a trouble. Okay, and it will cause trouble even here. If this submatrix rank is not 2, you will have trouble even here. So, there are issues which are deeply related to matrix rank if you make a wrong choice of the input excitation. Okay, very, very. Now, before sensitizing you about something which is reasonably advanced, I am not going to cover this part. Though I have given some exposure to this part towards the end of my notes, after the last slide, I have put some extra slides on this issue. There are two kinds of errors that can occur when you identify a model. One is called as a bias error, other is called as a variance error. I will just give you, sensitize you about this after I talk about the real example. So let's depart from here, go to this problem. Okay. Now this is the system which I have in my lab. Okay. I want to develop a black box model. Okay. I want to develop a black box model. If you want to play with the data, I can put it in Moodle. You can download the data and play with the data. Put it into IDENT toolbox, and then you can develop all kinds of models yourself. There are two inputs, okay, and there are two measurements. The Fortran problem, which we have been looking at for a long time, same problem. Sometime maybe after the mid-sem, we will actually visit the lab. I'll show you the setup. I have the setup. You can actually, and some of you are interested, you can do a project on that. You have freedom to do that. Instead of doing project on a toy simulation example, you can choose to do a project on, maybe I'll give a different weightage if you are going to do that. That is much more difficult. But you will learn far more if you do a project on a real data than if you do it with toy problem. Real problems are much more complex. So I have simultaneously perturbed both the inputs, two walls, simultaneously perturbed. Okay? Frequency content, I had to choose based on the knowledge of the time constants, rough idea of the time constants. I know that this particular plant, time constants are the order of 2 minutes. And based on that, I have made a call on how to do this. So these inputs can be generated using MATLAB identification toolbox. There is a function called ID input. Okay, you can give what type of input you want to generate, what should be the frequency content with reference to the Nyquist frequency pi by t. What fraction of Nyquist frequency? T is the sampling interval. Pi is pi. Of course, pi by t gives you Nyquist frequency. With reference to Nyquist frequency, what fraction you want to? So what is that fraction that you should decide knowing the plant frequency? Okay, that is critical. So it is very, very important that when you are exciting two inputs, they should not be identical. If they are identical, then that means rank of this matrix will not be n. Okay, they should not be scalar multiple of each other. If you are simultaneously perturbing a plant, they should be uncorrelated, and ID input will make sure if it simultaneously generate two inputs, it will generate uncorrelated inputs. So very, very critical that these two inputs should not have any correlation. Okay, very, very critical. That is the meaning of actually persistency of excitation. So these are the two outputs I collected, both the levels. Remember, each level is changing because of both the inputs simultaneously. It is not just function of one. Okay. Now I am going to do this. I am going to take part of the data for modeling and remaining for validation. Okay. The model which is developed using this part of the data should predict this behavior. Then only the model is good. Okay. I have developed variety of models. I have developed a second order output error model. The prediction seems to be okay. 87% fit means it's explaining some of the square of errors. System identification toolbox defines something called percentage fit using some of the square of errors. So it gives you a good measure of how good is the data. And mind you, this part of model validation has been carried out on this part of the data, this data. So these inputs have been given to the model identified. I want to check how well the prediction. So these means I have just shown here one graph, but actually up to 1000, okay, I have used for identification, and 1000 to whatever, 1300. So this part, both the inputs starting from 1000 to 1300 have been injected into the model, and I want to predict how well is level 1. So you can see that it's a good model. Unknown data is being predicted reasonably well using second order model. Well, in this case, the noise is uncorrelated. Great. Okay, no problem. You can go on developing different models. You can compare them on AIC criteria. I am just showing here autocorrelation of residuals. I have developed a third order Box Jenkins model. I have developed a fourth order. I am comparing different models. Well, Box Jenkins gives 89%, little more, little better than the other, and so on. So you can actually compare model output. These are the model parameters which will be obtained. Okay, so this case study, you can actually do it yourself. I'll upload this data. and you can take this into MATLAB toolbox, and then you can play with it. You can put all kinds of models and see what model parameters you get. Then you can take it to LTI view. You can compare the model frequency responses, step responses, impulse responses, Nyquist plots. You'll get better insight into what is happening. So you can develop a variety of models at your fingertips, and it's not so. Of course, when you go for controller design, you have to take a call which one of them you are going to use and how. So the next part logically is going to be using them for controller design, and my next lecture is going to be converting these models. See, I have these models into this transfer function form. Okay, my entire course is based on discrete time state space models. Whether one should work using transfer function models or state space models, well, it's a matter of choice. There, in control, there are two communities: one swear by transfer function, others like only state space. I belong to the state space category. I like to work with state space because you can use linear algebra. Okay, not that you cannot do linear algebra when you are using transfer functions, but a matrices containing polynomials of Q, their manipulations become very messy if you go for higher order systems. For state space, in my opinion, whether you work with single input, single output, or multiple input, multiple output, maths remains same. Everything is. So industry does prefer state space. A lot of controllers are written using state space realizations. So what I'm going to in my next lecture is what is called as state space realization of a time series model. I want to convert my model into a state space model. So basically, I will start with this, okay, and systematically explain how do I come up with a state realization, okay, which will look like this in the standard form. Okay, in this particular case, X may not have any physical meaning. Unlike when you start from physics and develop a state space model, okay, the state X has a physical meaning: temperature, pressure, level, whatever. It comes from physics. In this case, when I start from this transfer function model and go to this thing called state realization, okay, X has no physical meaning. What is physically meaningful here is U, which is the input, and Y. Y is the measurement. And all that you are saying is that this difference equation, okay, has the same transfer function as this. Okay, so the next part of this is going to be connecting up with this standard form. If you remember, we developed this standard form starting from physics, starting from first principle models. We linearized, developed the standard form. Now I'm going to develop this standard form starting from this data-driven black box model. Okay, finally, when I start working with the controller development, I'm just going to use this standard form. I am not worried where does it come from. Whether it comes from physics, whether it comes from completely data, whether it comes from some merger of data and physics, it's up to the model developer. Okay, I am just going to work with this standard model form for controller design, synthesis, whatever. Okay, so that's how the game plan is, that you could start with physics if you have a physics model. You could start with data if you have a data-driven model. Finally, you come up with this one standard form and then do your maths on this standard form. See, once you have translated the reality or the system into a mathematical description, okay, then you are in the world of mathematical models. You can do all kinds of manipulations. Okay, so I'm going to stick to the standard form and do all the manipulations. That's my game plan. Okay. So how to do this from starting from, is there a unique way of doing this? There are all kinds of questions. We'll answer these questions. You know, how do you go from here to here? Okay, there's so many ways of doing it. There's no unique way of doing it. You can show that there are infinite ways of doing it. So we are going to prefer and do it by some 2-3 different ways which are popular. Okay, but that, let's reserve that for the next class. So that's where the story ends, that you start with data, you come up with this time series models, you convert them into state space model, and then I'll use the state space model for control. Okay. They should not have correlation. They may or may not have different frequency content. It depends upon, some inputs have very fast influence on the outputs. Some inputs have slow influence on the outputs. You know, difficult to generalize. It depends upon the system. When you validate it, that thing is not so critical. In validation, data can be correlated, validation data can be uncorrelated. Identification, you better make sure that the inputs are uncorrelated, particularly if you are simultaneously exciting. Okay. So statistical properties of the input signal and frequency domain properties of the input signal are equally important when you design these inputs for identification. Validation, it is not. Which input? What if input is white noise? If you give white noise, well, on paper, ideal input is white noise. Okay. Then, if you have white noise, then the, you know, then the persistency of excitation is as much as you want. You can develop any model, but white noise is not a great signal to inject. Okay. So we typically do not inject white noise. We inject a colored noise. So see, you can see here, no, that if I inject this signal, if I am injecting this signal, it's a colored noise. It has only, see, what is white noise? It has all the frequencies. So that would be ideal signal. And if you inject white noise, then you know white noise is the perfectly persistently exciting signal. Nothing better than that. But white noise cannot be injected, in reality. In computer simulations, you can inject white noise, you will get great models, but not practical. Okay. So this matrix will be, you know, perfectly conditioned if you introduce white noise, because you know, this matrix will be diagonal. If you introduce white noise, this matrix is diagonal, nothing like it, but you cannot do that in practice. Okay, I'll just briefly talk about this now, maybe I'll continue in the next lecture. There are two fundamental issues, and to understand this, actually you have to change the gear, and it becomes much more complex than whatever we have been doing till now. If you consider whatever we have been doing till now is simple, then this is relatively more complex. Okay, the analysis has to be done in frequency domain, okay, because in time domain you can do identification and all those things, but the insights come only from frequency domain. To go from time domain to frequency domain, insights using two norm is very, very critical, because there are certain relationships, transformations from time domain to relationship, come only because you define two norm. And you can, best books for this is System Identification by Leung or Soderstrom and Stoikar. These are two books which are, I have listed them in my, they are two control engineers who have written excellent books which give a lot of insights into these aspects. Now let me explain what is this animal. See, you have GQ, let's assume that there exists for a given system, there exists something called a true transfer function. Okay, don't ask me a question whether for a real car or does it exist? It doesn't exist. It's a hypothetical scenario. Suppose that it exists. Suppose it exists. Then the question is, will you reach it when you identify it from data? Okay. This question you can definitely ask for a computer simulation. If I am, when I am simulating a plant inside the computer, I am God, I am creating the world inside my computer program. So I know that there is a perfect system GQ, and I give to a modeler only data and ask him to identify. Question is, will he be able to reach the truth only from data? Okay. Now, there are two problems. See, if I give you a data for a system, let's say for a boiler, okay, you know that boiler is something which is a real boiler, is interconnected system of multiple systems. Okay, so actually, what should be the order of this system? It should be high order. It will be typically high order system. Okay, but as a modeler, I don't want to use large number of differential equations or difference equations. I want to keep them small. So I tend to choose a lower order model. Okay, classic example is, you know, let's say in process control, we use this kind of models. These are called as time delay, dead time plus time constant model. First order time constant plus a dead time. This is used to approximate a high order model. Why this? Because this is a simple model, one time constant and one time delay, as compared to eighth order model. Eighth order model means eighth order differential equation or eight first order differential equations. Okay. So instead of that, I like to work with one differential equation, you know. So, but what has happened, if I, for a real plant which is like this, if I approximate using this model, okay, there is a structural error between the true plant and the model, okay, and this gives rise to something called bias error, okay. See, if you look at the step responses, they look similar, okay. This blue is the true step response. This step response is of the first FOBTD is first order plus time delay model. These models are available in system identification toolbox. You can go and it will tell you which kind of model you want to identify. You can say that I don't want ARX OE, I want FOBTD model. It will give you a model which is of this form. It will give you a model of this form. If you just compare the step responses of these two, they look very, very similar. You might say a good model. I mean, I am getting there, you know. The step responses are similar. If I compare the frequency responses of these two models, see, if I say that this is the true plant, this is the estimated model for the true plant, then, you know, and if I just show you this validation, we'll say good model, I'll use this for control. Okay, look at the frequency responses. The comparison of frequency responses, this is the model frequency response. Okay, 1 minute. And this green one is the plant, eighth order model. This is my approximation, which is first order but time delay approximation. It is very good only in the low frequency region. Match is very good in the low frequency region. Okay, but as in the high frequency region, this match is not good. Suppose your controller in closed loop, you are operating in this region, in this frequency band. There is a large mismatch between the model and the plant. That will give you big problem when you control. Yeah, that will give you big problem when you control. Okay, now what you can do is, okay, this is called bias error. And this is going to occur in most of the situations, real situations. Real situations, real problems are very high order. Okay, we always approximate them using low order models. So when you approximate a high order system using a low order model, there is always a bias error. Okay, because your model is not able to capture the reality. It has limitations. Okay, what you can do, of course, is that you can shift this error. You can say that, well, instead of good match in the low frequency, I want a good match in this frequency. How do I do that? I go back and say that I will use this signal for input excitation than using this signal. So, using this signal for instead of this signal, will it ensure that you will get good model in that frequency range? Yes. So, that I will talk about in my next lecture. I will just hint at next in my next lecture. You can show that, well, you can shape the difference between the true and the estimated using the power spectrum of inputs. So, how do you shape the power spectrum of inputs has lot of bearing in what region, what frequency band the model is good, what frequency band the model is bad. Okay. So, all this analysis comes only with two norm, that's why we use two norm. Yeah. So, this I am just going to sensitize you, not really get into deep, because this might need 2 or 3 weeks of lecture if I want to really get into